Now I look up. I'm in the back of a patrol car. I seen everything that I had been taken for granted, and probably even my freedom snatched away from me in the blink of an eye. I didn't know what to expect.
He's exactly like how he is now. He was very confident. He was a very confident person, period. When he was around 2 years old, his parents were in their room, and Eddie wanted to come to their room, and they told him he couldn't sleep in there. So he took the initiative at 2 years old, mind you. He went and got his bed. It was a twin bed, and he's only two, and he pulled the whole bed into the hallway, into their room. That's his personality. He's always been very strong, very confident, and very determined.
Like, just his persistency and him being so mannerable, you know, and just on the right path, I knew he would always be something. He wouldn't be just sitting back not doing anything. He was a special kid.
That, you know, everybody knew Eddie. Everybody liked Eddie. Yeah, he was just, you know, he was just good with people and just kind of good at bringing everybody together.
Man, Ed, we used to call him Head when we was kids because he had a big head. But yeah, he was always tough. His dad was the first person to get us playing football.
Ed, as a little kid, he's always a little man as a little kid. I remember holding his mama's hand, coming out of church one Sunday and opened the door for her. From that moment on, the next time he would want to grab her hand, he would want to open the door for her. And then as he opened the door, because we had a truck, open the door, now he opened the door for her and closed the door. You look down looking for him, he's standing by the door because he needs somebody to open the door for him. You know, he was just always that little man as a kid.
Yeah, bro, that's where I came from, man. The history in the making right here. You know, had my homeboy Meech. This is his house. Man, it's crazy to see what it is now, bro. It was so fun when we was growing up. I'm talking about all my cousins, bro. We grew up in this house, man. I had my first fist fight over there at Liberty Park. Miss Kitty, our neighbor right here, kept us in check. Bro, it's crazy to see, you know what I'm saying, where I came from, man.
I say, 4 or 5 years old, I remember playing hide and seek with my cousins. I seen my first dead body in the alley, man. All kind of crazy things. Growing up, that stuff become normal to you. You know, seeing my first drug raid at 6 years old. I didn't know what a drug raid was. I just seen people hopping out cars, trucks with guns. I'm running down the street, mama, grandma, somebody just broke in such and such house, you know?
Highland Park taught you survival.
Yes.
Wife mentioned on it. If you can be brought, raised up by the park, you can go anywhere on the face of the earth and survive.
Growing up in the city where you feel like you gotta hold your own. My parents, as they see the activity that was continuing to happen, they decided to get me out. At the time, I didn't agree with it. I was wondering, like, why y'all keeping me away from the fun? You take me out to the suburbs, all my friends, you know? But looking back, I can definitely say I appreciate it. You know, they seen something that I didn't.
Believe it or not, Highland Park was a lovely place growing up. By far, what school Ed went to was all this kid.
I always said that I would invest in my son's future, and I thank God that we did.
Going into high school, it was like a different world for me almost. I feel like my life transition, I was in the environment with individuals my age had businesses, had wealth passed down from generations before them, you know? So that put a desire in my heart, like, man, that's something I want to make happen for my family one day. I want my sons, daughters, godchildren, cousins. I want them to be able to, you know, live life stress-free, worry-free, and just worry about what it is they need to do in order to make their dreams come true.
Now, I want to share one testimony about this young man in school, how diligent we was about him staying in school. If you'd have had the payments for your kids to stay in school, well, they'd give you a call, like, come and pick your kid up.
Or he'd be suspended.
Or he'd be suspended for school until the payment was made. At this particular time, I was at work. Well, the night before, I'm sitting here trying to, you know, pluck every hair out of my head, how are we gonna get this money for this kid?
Speaking of sacrifices.
To stay in school. Now, he didn't know he was about to get kicked out of school. He jumped up just to jolly. I'm like, so you don't realize this is your last day, buddy. You're about out of here. He don't know it. He get dressed and, you know, and I tell the wife, take him on school, you know. I go to work. We prayed that night before. But when I get to work, all of a sudden, it's like, I told my boss, you know, I need to go home. You know, can I get the day off? He said, well, sure, you know. Now, personally, I don't understand why I asked for the day off, but I just knew I needed the day off. I come home, and I come home, the wife is clean up the kitchen at the time. And I don't drink pop. Well, I didn't at the time. And all of a sudden, I had a crave for a fagel and a newspaper. Yes, that's odd, but that's what I had a crave for, a fagel and a newspaper. And we didn't have any money. I had maybe about $1.80 in my pocket, maybe $2 in my pocket. And so at this time, I told the wife, I said, I'm gonna go to the store. Now, the store is right around the corner from my house. But when I get in the car, for some reason, I'm just driving. And I go past a store. Matter of fact, I passed about four stores. Then I just said, well, I'm gonna go up in this gas station. I said, well, I'm gonna go ahead and get me my fagel and my newspaper. So I goes up there, pay for my, I might have had 20 cents, maybe 30 cents left in my pocket. And all of a sudden I open the door, gas station, it's pouring down rain. I park right in front of the door. It's pouring down rain. So I said, well, let me take off running to the car because it was pouring like cats and dogs. But as I'm running towards my car, for some reason, I just see somebody at the door and I just picked it up and jumped in the car and just, you know, just, man, just shaking because it was cold. So I sit in there for a minute, trying to, you know, dry up a little bit. And all of a sudden, I grabbed this bag that I picked up or something. And it was a sandwich bag, but it was a sandwich bag full of money. So I'm sitting there, I'm like, wow, what am I gonna do? Like, you know, I'm just looking at this money. Well, I'm saying, well, if somebody come knock on the door and say, hey, did you find anything? I don't care if they say you find the pops, I'm throwing them that money because I'm nervous now. Because I found, I don't know how much in it, but it was in the sandwich bag. So now I'm just watching people as they walk out, and I can actually kind of barely see them because it's raining so hard. And so about four people walk out. I see some young guys, they walk out. And one of them actually kind of looked towards the car or something. I'm like, you know, ready to blow the horn. Come here, whatever you're looking for, you know. I'm just nervous. So finally, no one came to the car. So I pulls off. And I'm looking in my rear mirror. I said, well, if anyone come behind me, you know, I'm pulling over and tell them I found this, you know. As I'm driving down Greenfield, crossing 8 Mile, I still haven't looked and see what's in the bag, but I know it's money in the bag. I'm driving, so I drive past the house just in case somebody's following me. Mind you, I'm still nervous. I found the bag. And so I drive past the house, and I go around the corner, and I'm about to turn up in my driveway. So I circle the block one more time just in case somebody follow me. So this time I pull up, and I jumped out of the car. And I opened the door, and I said, Sylvia, I said, look what I found. I still don't know what it is. We open up. It's a knot of money. They had, whoever had it, they had it lined up from hundreds, fifties, 20s, tens, fives. Now I'm like, well, thank you, Jesus, you know, because we start counting the money.
The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just.
And that scripture kept coming to me. Mm-hmm. And I kid you not, the scriptures that kept coming. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just.
Man.
And I thought about the prayer we prayed, and also we was tithing. So I thought about that. I kept saying, wait a minute. This is for us right here. And so we started counting the money. I said, hold on, that's enough for his school to be paid. That's that payment.
Mm-hmm.
Then, you know, we looked in there, we didn't have no food. That's enough for that right there. And, you know, I'm already riding on E because I only had 30 cents. I don't know why I pulled up the gas station to get this pop and
newspaper
that I wanted. So here's enough for that. Then the next thing we looked at each other, we just started crying. Thank you, Jesus.
Still wanting to be, you know, prove I was tough, hood. I was still, you know, hanging with my guys, doing what he do.
We went out to party, but we went out to fight. Because we knew, you know, every party was going to lead to something. Somebody's going to look at us crazy, or one word is going to lead to another. I mean, man, talking about weekend to weekend, fight after fight after fight. Then one fight led to a brother of mine, my brother, getting stabbed, you know? That kind of slowed everything down for me. But the final wake-up call, I could say, is me and one of my best friends, right before he, you know, leaving to go off to school the next morning. Like, man, I just want to party in the city one more time. Something in my spirit told me, like, just relax. But me being me at the time, the individual I was, we had to be in the scene. We go to this block party, we weren't even there for 5 minutes. You know, dudes get to arguing over a pair of glasses, one thing led to another, a fist thrown, a shot thrown, turned into a shootout. So we take off running, it's a shootout right in front of us. I'm running, a girl gets shot in the head right next to me, you know? I look back, I don't see nothing but her head, her brains laying on the curb.
So from there, I took football serious, you know. I blame it on football. I can't go out this weekend. I got a camp in the morning. I got a college visit. I got coaches coming to see me, anything. So blessed to receive a scholarship, go play football on the collegiate level, get to school. You feel like you grown, you on your own. But being a student athlete also wasn't easy. You know, you come from the hustle. So it was plenty nights I'm hungry, you know. I still gotta make ends meet on my end. You don't wanna call home every time and ask mom and dad for some cheese. Something get hard, I kinda say I didn't do what I was supposed to.
It was like life was so fun. I remember taking trips, talking with my homeboys, like, man, she looked nice on the gram. I'm about to fly her out here. Well, I'm about to fly her out here, you know. And that's all that really mattered to me, but it was still no peace.
My mother was hospitalized with congestive heart failure that we thought was just a cramp, stomach cramp. Ended up her being hospitalized for almost a year. That summer is where grind was started. So doing workouts, you know, you record workouts, I'm saying grind. I'm like, I know this could turn into something. I didn't know what, but I knew it could be something. So put it on a t-shirt, working out with it. You know, people mess with the first logo, which was a sleepwalker. It was more so me representing my lifestyle at the moment. You know, I'm sleeping in the hospital with my mother, getting up to go and work out. I'm sleeping in a recliner chair. I see my father doing the same, getting up 4 o'clock in the morning, getting up at six, you know, in the evening. So I wanted to put something to represent my lifestyle, but something that other people could also relate to, and that they rock. I was feeling at this moment, you know, I want to be an entrepreneur. School wasn't teaching me how to be the best business owner, or entrepreneurs teaching you how to be the best employee is what I'm feeling like. Why would I graduate and have to go work for somebody else? Where is it that I'm learning how to start my business from ground up? So I decided, you know, take a break from school for a minute.
So coming from Ohio, being a student athlete, having a place of my own, Being an adult, being on my own, coming back to my parents' household was like a big adjustment for myself. Pride got in the way. It was like I was taking steps back in life.
On top of not receiving the information I felt that I should have been receiving in order to advance in the next stage of my life. It was so much, man, going around in my life at one time. Mother just getting out the hospital. Not even 90 pounds. I had to help her walk again, get dressed, eat. You know, then my cousin that was really like my brother. I lose him to gunplay. You know, two homeboys, one to cancer, one in a car accident. Uncle's back in the system. I won't see him till another decade. It was just like, what else could go wrong, man? I just went numb.
Getting my hands back into everything, you know, from the neighborhood. Anything you could think of, pills, scams, drugs, whatever it may be. I felt I had to do what I had to do at that moment.
Seeing what other people were doing, I let that get in the way of my vision. So one day, you know, in the neighborhood, chopping it up with a couple fellas, we like, let's put a trip together. A week later, we got on the road.
That night that he left, it's like, it was one of, our sleep was like, it was just, it was
restless.
Restless that whole night.
And there was plenty of warnings for me not to do this, but like I said, I felt I had to do what I had to do. So I decided to, you know, get on the road. And as I'm headed to the destination, the driver wakes us up like, man, the police behind us. So, you know, we smoking, you know, already doing illegal. I'm smoking. So I wake up, you know, try to stash what I had in such a little time. Next thing I know, we pulled over. I'm in the back of a police car, headed to jail facing felony charges.
And I kept seeing this number show on my phone. And I don't know, you know, no 419 number. It's showing in my phone. So I didn't answer it because I was, you know, working. Then it came again. I didn't answer it. Then so for some reason, I played my voicemail here. Normally I wouldn't play my voicemail, but I played my voicemail and it was Ed saying that he got in some trouble, come and get him. My heart just dropped. The world just stopped for that second. Just like I got quiet, that's how things just stopped.
With the case, what I could say, what's the most challenging part about that? It wasn't the possibility of sitting down for the amount of time that they were trying to, you know, give me the face. It wasn't really the trial. It was the fact it was like disappointment to my family. It's like, man, am I a failure? My family to sacrifice so much, you know, putting me through private education, the extracurricular activities, clothes on my back, you know, shoes on my feet to make sure that I had what I wanted and more. You understand what I'm saying? And to get a visit by my parents, you know, and my girlfriend at the time, and all I could do was talk to them, you know, in handcuffs on my feet and my, you know, my hands and my feet and talk through a glass, it was like, wow. I knew I had so much to offer the world and that I was letting my ministry go to waste, my gift, my talent that God has blessed me with, that I was taking that for granted. So I put it in a different aspect of my own father. You know, if he gave me this, gave me that, it's like, dang, it was a slap in your face to go do this. You understand what I'm saying? And there's so much respect for my physical father that it's like, God does way more for me than him, you know what I'm saying? And than anybody, you know? That's for anything, though. God wake you up every morning. What more can you ask for? You get what I'm saying? And it was like, that put a fire in me, bro. I got out, took it serious, and it was like, let's do it.
His life sped up on him. So his grind became double what he was already doing. To make a change, now he's going through court system, now he's going to probation, now he's got to do community service. Everything to him seemed like, you could just see him, it was like a movie. every day he's doing different things. Every day he's cutting loose certain things. Every day he's adding certain things. Every day he's up focused. You don't have to tell this young man, you need to do this. He was doing it. He was grinding every day.
Amen.
Every day. He was doing two jobs where he was had to get his mom to take him to work because he sleep from the job he just getting off so he can get to take a nap to get to the other job. He was grinding.
Right. It's like I worked hard and I earned everything that I had. And I continue to pray. Stand strong with my faith. When people say, like, all you talk about is God and the brand, well, that's all I had. My back was against the wall. What else was I supposed to talk about?
Eddie, I don't call him nothing but grind. But I done seen him go from here to here. Now he got his shit in stores. He got more celebrities rocking it.
Let me see what you work with, man. Okay. My man.
Doing all this shit with kids, which I really like, which I've been trying to get into myself, you know, to mentor and give back. You know, I like the positive message and what he's doing.
Pressure makes diamonds, you know, so when we talk about the grind in general, that's just the everyday procedure, the process. Like I said, my whole family has always been entrepreneurs, hardworking people, so I mean, it's just the steps that you take toward the ultimate goal, and that's to be successful.
What Ed is doing, honestly, is more of a calling, in my opinion. He has an anointing on him. He always has. Of course, when he was born, you know, you think great things, you want the best for your family, but it was something more special other than just the typical, oh, I love my nephew or I love my family member. He definitely has a calling on his life. And I know that now with grind, in my opinion, is something that he's starting to embrace.
Just hearing him as a young man praying in the morning, interceding and going in, I see my son cry out to God things that you guys would probably never even know and imagine. But I see that this young man has a personal relationship with God and with his mother, his father, his family he loved dearly. I know deeply in my heart that he's gonna be great and he will change this world.
If you breathe, then it's a chance, man. Never give up on your dream. I come here with this hoodie to tell them chase your dreams. You know? Your story is still being written. It's not where you are. Your situation is not your conclusion. It's still being written. You know? I use this as motivation. Like you can see, there's nothing here, bro. There's nothing here. This is the grind. This is that. This is made me, bro. If this not motivation, I don't know what else do you need?
Anybody else, man, coming from my situation, I'm a living testimony. It can be done. It is another way out. It's not just sports. It's not just athletics. Do what it is that you feel makes you happy, what success means to you. Chase after that. Chase after your dream. You know, you don't have to be rich. You don't have to have this person and that person in your life. Use what you don't have. Use it as motivation. Don't operate in fear. It's your dream. You know what I'm saying? It's a God-given ministry to you. Don't worry about others' opinions, what they think, what they may think, what they may do. Do what it is that makes you happy, bro. Chase after your dream. The sky's the limit.
And so we just thank God for everything, and I'm so glad that y'all came by.
This one for the hood right here. Song dedicated to anybody out there got some dreams. Don't give up on your dreams, real talk. You ready, Keys? Let's go. Close to jail, it feels like I'm so close to hell. Mom smoking, same shit I'm selling.